Hello student, welcome to this topic of ferroelectrics. So dielectrics are basically insulators. Their charging conditions can be altered by application of an external electric field. If a dielectric material is possessing permanent electric dipoles, then it's called as a ferroelectric. So therefore, ferroelectric is basically a dielectric. Since this material is having the permanent electric dipoles, this kind of dielectrics are called as the ferroelectrics. So ferroelectrics are considered as nonlinear dielectrics. That means the polarization process in the ferroelectric materials is not linear to the applied field. That is why these are called as the nonlinear dielectrics, or the changes which are taking place in the material due to application of electric field are nonlinear, and hence it is called as a nonlinear dielectric. The general properties of ferroelectrics are listed below. So the first property is that ferroelectrics possesses spontaneous polarization. The permanent electric dipole moments present in the ferroelectrics have aligned in one direction, even in the absence of external electric field. So this is the phenomena of spontaneous polarization. The permanent electric dipole moments are aligned in one direction, even in the absence of the external electric field. So this phenomenon is called as the spontaneous polarization. This is the very, very important property of the ferroelectrics. So next, ferroelectrics are polar dielectrics. That means the center of positive charge distribution does not coincide with the center of the negative charge distribution. Next, the ferroelectrics exhibit the phenomenon of hysteresis, where the polarization P lags behind the applied electric field. So just like how the ferromagnetic materials exhibit the phenomenon of hysteresis, these ferroelectric materials also exhibit the phenomenon of hysteresis. And the spontaneous magnetization, this property, spontaneous polarization, is analogous to the spontaneous magnetization in ferromagnetic material. So that is why there is a lot of similarity between the properties of these ferroelectric material and ferromagnetic materials. So next, exhibit the hysteresis phenomenon. Next, the ferroelectric behavior disappears above a certain temperature called the ferroelectric cure temperature. So there is a critical temperature called as the ferroelectric cure temperature, below which the material is exhibiting all the properties of ferroelectrics, like hysteresis, all those things. But above this temperature, all these properties are destroyed. So it will be simply behaving as a normal dielectric. Such a critical temperature is called as the ferroelectric cure temperature. Next, the first order phase transition involves latent heat, while for a second order phase transition, the specific heat involved will exhibit a discontinuity. This is another property. And the spontaneous polarization in the ferroelectric state is associated with the spontaneous electrostatic strains in the crystal. So because of the presence of electrostatic stresses, a strain is developed. That is called as the electrostatic strains. And these strains are responsible for the spontaneous alignment of the ferroelectric dipoles in one direction. And then the next point is that the dielectric constant epsilon of a ferroelectric is not a constant, but it depends on the field strength at which it is measured. So this important property called the dielectric constant of so many materials is generally a constant for at a given temperature, but here the dielectric constant of this material changes as a function of the applied field, electric field. And the next point is that the dielectric constant epsilon so defined is very large in the vicinity of the transition temperature. It is of the order of 10 to the power 4 to 10 to the power 5. That means vicinity of the transition temperature. That means when the temperature of the material is near the critical temperature, at that time what happens, the material will possess abnormally high dielectric constant. This is because of the enhanced growth and movements of the domain walls inside the material. So that phenomena leads to the higher dielectric constant near the transition temperature. Next point is that the above the transition temperature, dielectric constant obeys the Curie-Weiss law. So this is the Curie-Weiss law, just like it is the Curie-Weiss law for the ferromagnetic materials. There also Curie-Weiss law is there. This Curie-Weiss law is also satisfied by these ferroelectric materials, where this C dash is called as the Curie constant, and epsilon naught is the permittivity of a free space, and this theta is the characteristic temperature for the given material. And next is the existence of spontaneous polarization is necessary but not a sufficient condition for ferroelectricity. It is not electricity, this is a ferroelectricity. So this we can't say that by mere presence of the spontaneous polarization the material is ferroelectric. Some other conditions should also be satisfied, then only the material can be called as a ferroelectric material. So these are the properties of the ferroelectric materials. Next we'll see how the classification is done. So classification of the ferroelectric materials. Ferroelectric materials are classified into the following categories. Three categories are there. First one is the tartarate group. The best example is the Rochelle salt. The second one is the dihydrogen phosphates and arsenates of alkali metals. And the third group is the oxygen octahedron group. It is called, the best example for this kind of group of material is the barium titanate. So you'll see the first one, the tartarate group. In this group, the first ferroelectric crystal discovered is the Rochelle salt of chemical composition NaKCH4H4O6.4H2O. So it is called as a double tartarate of sodium and potassium with four molecules of water. About 24 degree centigrade, the crystal is orthorhombic, as shown in the phase diagram one. And in orthorhombic region, the three crystal axes are of twofold symmetry, and therefore the crystal is not a ferroelectric. This point is very, very interesting or important. So in orthorhombic region, the three crystal axes of the axis are there, which are of twofold symmetry, or in general we can say that at this region, at this temperature, the material is having the symmetry elements. So that this qualifies the material to be called as a ferroelectric, because the ferroelectric state don't have any symmetry elements. So because for a crystal to be ferroelectric, you should not have any symmetry elements. That is the point. And next, below the in transition temperature, the crystal is slightly distorted and transformed into monoclinic structure. So in the ferroelectric region, the spontaneous polarization is along the x-axis. So below the transition temperature, the crystal is slightly distorted, and that transforms into another structure called as the monoclinic structure. So in the ferroelectric region, the spontaneous polarization is along the x-axis. So this is the phase diagram for the plot of relative directed constant versus the temperature. We can call this also the phase diagram, because this diagram shows how the phases of the material are going to change. So in this region, the rock and salt will be possessing the orthorhombic structure, and between these two regions, this is possessing the monoclinic structure, and beyond this temperature, it again possesses the orthorhombic structure. So as the temperature changes, accordingly, the structure of the this material also changes. So these structures are along the x-axis, but the same property is measured along the y and z-axis. There nothing is changed. They are the straight lines. So this third diagram shows that this shows the hysteresis loop phenomena also. So this is the plot of polarization versus the applied electric field, and as the field is increased from zero, the polarization takes this path and reaches the saturation at B, and when the field is reversed in opposite direction, starts decreasing in other path, and even though the field is decreased to zero, it retains some value here at point C, and this point, this much OC is called as the retentive polarization. To reduce the retentive polarization, we have to supply the electric field in the reverse direction. So that is why when the field is applied in negative direction, the polarization takes plot, and lastly it comes to zero at the point D. So this much negative field OD is called as the coercive field. So therefore, the coercive field is a field which is required to reduce the retentive polarization to zero. So in this figure four, a plot of spontaneous polarization versus the temperature, and this shows that Rochel salt is having the two limits or two critical temperatures. Here one temperature is here, another temperature is here. So within this volume, it is a ferroelectric in nature. Beyond these two temperatures, it is not a ferroelectric structure. And when this Rochel salt is doped with deuterium isotope, which is the isotope of the hydrogen, then this loop takes this form. This shows that the spontaneous polarization is almost doubled when this Rochel salt is doped with the deuterium. So all these things are explained. And there are other tartarate isomorphs with the Rochel salt with the replacement of potassium by rubidium, thallium, or ammonia. but none of them are ferroelectrics. So these are the other some materials similar to the Rochelle salt. So this is the structure of Rochelle salt. You can see this kind of structure it is having. Here potassium ion is there, and here sodium ion is there. The hydroxyl, two hydroxyl groups are here, and here it also have some double bonds here and here. So this is the structure of the Rochelle salt. Next, we will see the second group of ferroelectric materials. It is called as the dihydrogen phosphates, and how these dihydrogen phosphates will be there, the second group. So the most important member of the tetrahedral phosphate group of ferroelectric substance is the potassium dihydrogen phosphate, KH2PO4. It is a potassium dihydrogen phosphate. It is a very known type of the ferroelectric material, second type of ferroelectric material, and it has a curie point of nearly -150°C. Above the curie temperature, the crystal has a tetragonal structure with the shell dimensions A equal to B, B equal to 7.545 angstroms, and C is equal to 6.96 angstroms. Below the curie point, it is an orthorhombic structure. So this material also changes its structure if the temperature is changing. So each atom is surrounded tetrahedrally by four oxygen atoms here, and each phosphate group is surrounded tetrahedrally by four other phosphate groups. So these groups are connected together by the hydrogen bonds. And below the curie temperature, the original square base becomes slightly distorted into a rectangle. You can see this diagram. Originally it is a perfect square. This is the base of the crystal structure of this material. So it is a perfect square below the curie temperature. So I will come to this point. Below the curie temperature, the original square base becomes slightly distorted into a rectangle. So originally this is a square, but when the temperature is above curie temperature, the crystal structure is distorted to a rectangle like this. You see, it is distorted structure. So the structure gets distorted into a rectangle. The small cell, which is rhombic, may be considered as being the result of shear stresses applied to the cell ABCD as shown in the figure. So this change in the structure is thought of because of the shear stresses developed in the material. Why the shear stresses develops in the material? Because some of the metallic ions displaces from their positions, so that leads to development of some stress and strains. So that also leads to the change in the structure. Next, because of the piezoelectric effect, the shear strain S6 induces an electric field in the Z direction. So piezoelectric effect is such a phenomena where there can be some changes in the dimensions of the material when that material is kept under the influence of the electric field. So why is this kind of changes in the dimensions of the material takes place? Because inside the material, the metal ions are displacing from their position, So that leads to some small, very, very small change in the dimensions of the body. So different strains are there when you study the elastic properties of this material. So one of the such strain is the S6, which induces an electric field in the Z direction. Based on this model, D. Quervain proposes that the spontaneous polarization can be estimated as follows. So the spontaneous polarization is given by PS is equal to EC into EZ, or this is equal to EC into S6 divided by D36, where this EC or epsilon C is the dielectric constant along the CRZ axis, and D36 is the piezoelectric constant. This D36 is the piezoelectric constant. Other ferroelectric crystals belonging to this tetragonal phosphate family include KDPO4, potassium deuterium phosphate, which is having a critical temperature of 213 Kelvin, and rubidium dihydrogen phosphate having the a critical temperature of 146 degrees centigrade, and cesium dihydrogen arsenate is having the cure temperature of 143 degree Kelvin, and cesium deuterium arsenate is having the cure temperature of 220 degrees centigrade. What is important point is that all these materials have the cure temperature which is below 0 degree centigrade. So that is the very, very important point. So that is why at room temperature, even at room temperature, they behave differently, and they are very, very sensitive to the change in the temperature. So this is the structure formed by the metal ions present in this phosphate group. You can see here. So in this, so these are the axis of the crystal, and these 011, 101, these are the different directions of the crystal, and here tetrahedral is there. This tetrahedral group is formed by the phosphate ions. So this is a structure. Another structure is shown here. So this this potassium and this phosphate is there. It is also making a tetrahedral structure like this. Here double bond is there, and this is one oxygen is connected to this this metal ion loosely. So this is the structure. So this is about the ferroelectrics, and I have explained the two types of ferroelectrics, and in the next class I will explain the third type of the ferroelectrics. Thanks for listening.